Good morning, Eagleville. So glad to see you guys here. Come on in, find a seat. We're glad that you are here. And if you are a guest, you should have received a bulletin. On the bottom of that bulletin, please give us your information. We'd love to get a hold of you to learn how we can best serve you. And if you have any prayer requests, on the back of that bulletin, there's a spot for you to fill it out. Good morning. So so glad to have everybody here. Glad to have Dave White here. He'll be giving a presentation, so and his bride. So would you please stand, and let's ready our hearts to worship the Lord. We'll begin with prayer. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for this time together as a family, Lord, as a body that represents you and all of your goodness. And so, Lord, as we lift up song, as we lift up our hearts, our souls, our minds, and all of our strength, God, we give to you as we enter into times of worship, God, seeking you. And so, Father, bless all of this service with your grace, with your presence, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Once I was lost, wandering in darkness, no life inside, no hope inside. He called my name, he healed my blindness, set me ablaze. Now I'm alive with love breaking through my heart of stone. Love breathing to wake my bones. Love reaching out to save my soul. Love never gonna let me go.
Come on.
And now my heart's so full of worship, I can't hold back, I can't contain it. For all he's done, Jesus, my Savior, I am ablaze, so full of thanks for. Love breaking through my heart of stone. Love breathing to wake my bones. Love reaching out to save my soul. Love never gonna let me go. Love calling me as I am. Love making me new again. Love lifting me when I can. Never gonna let me go.
Wherever you've been,
whatever you've done,
come as you are, come into his open arms.
Wherever you've been,
whatever you've done,
come as you are, come find his.
Love breaking through my heart of stone. Love breathing to wake my bones. Love reaching out to save my soul. Love never gonna let me go. Love calling me as I am. Love making me new again. Love lifting me when I can. Love never gonna let me go. Love breaking through my heart of stone. Love breathing to wake my bones. Love reaching out to save my soul. Love never gonna let me go. Love calling me as I am. Love making me new again. Love lifting me when I can't. Love never gonna let me go. Love never gonna let me go. Love never gonna let me go.
Of sin and darkness, whose love is mighty and so much stronger. The King of glory, the King above all kings. who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder, who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You would lay down your life. That I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Our chaos back into order, who makes the orphan a son and daughter. The King of glory, the King of glory, who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You would lay down your life. That I would be set free. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. You are worthy. Worthy, oh, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You would lay down your life. That I would be set free. I sing for all that you've done for me.
Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. Let me say a word of prayer as we take this morning's tithes and offerings. Dear Heavenly Father, God, just thank you so much for this opportunity we have this morning to come into your house this morning and to gather and to just worship your name, Lord, to draw near to you, God. And just thank you for the opportunity that that is, Lord. We just ask your blessing over this morning's service as we hear from Pastor Bill as he gives us the truth of your word, Lord, as we collect this morning's tithes and offerings. God, we ask that you bless the gift and the giver as we seek to do your will here in this county, Lord. Just, you know, we want to reach out to our friends, to our family, to our community, and win them for Christ, Lord. So just bless our efforts in that, Lord. Pray this. Also, God, I just want to lift up Doug Brown and his recovery. Had a very serious surgery earlier this week. Pray for the Summers family as well, the loss of Kelly's mom early this morning, God. Just just be with these families. Be with us as a church body and, you know, comfort them and be with them and lift them up in prayer, God. And just thank you that you always hear us, Lord. Pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. A few announcements this morning. The Wild Game Feast deer donation, we're still looking for donations for that. Don Barron's information is in your bulletin, so when you get a deer, look up Don and take your harvest there for processing. What do we have? Thanksgiving Eve service and the community dinner on November 27th from 4 to 6 p.m., and then the service right after starting at 7. If you feel free to sign up for that so we know who's coming, how many to prepare for. Also, if you would like to help out with that in any way, you can sign up to be a part of that. Red Cross Blood Drive is on Monday, December 16th. You can get signed up to help out with that or to donate blood. And then lastly, the Children's Christmas Program is on December 15th. That's a Sunday night. We're looking for a lot of cupcake donations for that. And then lastly, the adult Christmas Eve choir, the first practice is today right after church, right after the second service, right here in the gym. Meet with Pastor Mark and begin practicing. And also, we have a special guest. We have Dave. Come on up, Dave. He's Dave White. He's one of our missionaries that we support here at Eagleville. And so we have the opportunity to hear from him and hear of the work that he is doing.
Thank you so much. Like he said, my name's Dave, my wife Courtney. We're on staff with Crew, and many of you have been on board with us for a long time. Now, one of the things that's always interesting about being a missionary and coming into a setting like this is, like, I want to tell you everything we're doing, because I'm very passionate about it. I love what we're doing, and it's exciting. But oftentimes, it just kind of flies over people's heads because it's like, wait a minute, what did he say he's doing? Where is he at now? What are they doing? So I want to show you what your investment in our ministry has produced. And you can see it up here on the screen. This is a website that's come out of a partnership. And I had to open up the website myself because there's so many partners now. Where Crew, InterVarsity, which is another big college ministry, CCO, if you're familiar with that, out of the Pittsburgh area, and Unite Movement, Jews for Jesus, the Luke 18 Project, Moms in Prayer, Navigators, all these wonderful ministries have gotten together and say, listen, we really want to see every college campus in the United States have a gospel-centered movement. Okay, it's not a Crew movement, that's not an InterVarsity movement, that's a movement of God where college students get to hear the gospel. So Crew, InterVarsity, and all these other ministries, that's our area of expertise. That's something that we do well. I know how to talk to a college student. On the other hand, churches, Christian colleges, which is really kind of weird to say that a Christian college student wouldn't know how to talk to a secular college student, but it's a big jump when you go between two different environments, as well as anybody and everybody who would want to reach a campus with the gospel. Can be a part of this. And so Crew and InterVarsity and our other partners, we are giving away the best of what we do and how to reach college students with the gospel. And so you can see that here. We actually had them put in the zip code for the church. And these are the college campuses that are nearby you. Lakeland Community College, Kent State University at Ashtabula, Kent State University at Geauga, and Lake Erie College. Now, you'll notice that Kent State at Ashtabula, there's actually been one prayer walk. Someone went out and said, I'm going to pray for a gospel-centered movement on this campus. Okay, they didn't launch something. They didn't go in and have to share the gospel with someone. They just said, I'm going to put boots on the ground and pray for God to do something here. And that's the entirety of what we're doing. If you can go back one slide real quick, you can see there, there are 4,948 campuses in the United States right now. That ranges from rabbinical schools, places where Jewish people are going to be trained living out their faith, all the way to beauty colleges and two-year trade schools, and then all the way up to the Ohio States, the Wisconsins, the Penn States. And so our goal is to see every campus in the nation prayer walked, not just once, not just twice, but continually until there's a gospel-centered movement on every campus. And that's what we're asking for. So Go ahead and go back to the next slide. So you can see there, Kent State University at Ashtabula, one prayer walk. But we've got three other colleges that are close to you all that need to be prayer walked. And so that's my challenge to you guys. Your investment in Courtney and I has produced this. And we've seen almost, I think it's 25,000 or 2,500 campuses prayer walked already. But there's so many more to go. And so as you're driving to work, as you're considering, oh, you know, what can I do to help further the kingdom of God? Consider prayer walking some of these local campuses. And all you do is you go to the Every Campus site, you pull it up, you say, hey, you would literally click on one of those green boxes, and then that would take you to a prayer walking guide and would just walk you through, okay, what should I be looking for on this campus? What are the things that people are talking about? How can I be praying into that? How can I trust God to build a gospel-centered movement on that campus? And so I've taken the investment you've put into us and kind of turned it back to you all. And I want to challenge you. Consider when you pass a college campus. By the way, folks, Courtney and I flew in from Orlando last night. It's cold up here. And I know that many of you are thinking the same thing and will be traveling. Some of you will be going to see family over the Thanksgiving weekend. Some of you will be traveling over the winter break, or I'm talking like a college campus minister, over the winter holidays. Instead of saying like, okay, where's Chick-fil-A or where's the McDonald's or where's the thing I'm going to stop on my way to see my family, maybe consider going here and saying, hey, I know that there's this little community college that I drive by. I wonder what it would look like to stretch my legs and do a quick prayer walk around that campus, asking God to move. So that's what I want to challenge you guys to. As you've invested in us, we're very grateful for that. And we want to ask you guys to consider coming along with all these partners to genuinely see every student in the United States of America get a chance to hear about who Jesus is. Not from crew, not from InterVarsity, but from folks like you who are praying for gospel-centered movements on those campuses to see laborers raised up so that students get a chance to hear about Jesus, have their lives transformed by the message of the gospel, and then take it to the next person, and the next person, and the next person. Thanks so much for your support. Courtney and I think, are going to be out in the lobby afterwards. We'd love to answer questions, and even just make sure you all understand, like, hey, this is where the whites are going, and this is what they're doing with crew. Anything that you guys might have to ask, we'd love to answer. So thanks so much.
Please stand. Let's pray real quick. Heavenly Father, we want to pray for the whites, Lord. We want to pray a blessing over their family, over their ministry, oh God, every campus. Oh God, that you would hear the prayers of those that are faithful in praying. Lord God, that you would hear and respond and that you would save this generation, oh God. In Jesus' name, amen.
Attendeth my way.
11:22 says, "Consider therefore the kindness and sternness of God, sternness to those who fell, but kindness to you, provided that you continue in his kindness. Otherwise, you'll be cut off." And last week we introduced a song called "Raise a Hallelujah," and it's going to be my policy to try to honor this, to do it two weeks in a row, and I feel like it'll be easier the next time we do it if we do it 2 weeks in a row. So we're going to do it again. It's called "Raise a Hallelujah." You guys did great last week. Let's do it again for the Lord Jesus Christ.
Presence of my enemies, I'll raise a hallelujah louder than the unbelief. I'll raise a hallelujah. My weapon is a melody. I'll raise a hallelujah. Heaven comes to fight for me. I'm gonna sing in the middle of the storm, louder and louder.
to hear my praises roar up from the ashes. Hope will arise. Death is defeated. The King is alive.
Woo! I'll raise a hallelujah with everything inside of me. I'll raise a hallelujah. I will watch the darkness flee. I raise a hallelujah in the middle of the mystery. I raise a hallelujah. You lost, you hold on me. And I'm gonna sing in the middle of the storm. Louder and louder, you're gonna hear my praises roar up from the ashes. Hope will arise. Death is defeated. The King is alive.
Sing a little louder.
Heaven comes to fight for me.
Sing a little louder.
In the presence of my enemy.
Sing a little louder.
Louder than the unbelief.
Sing a little louder.
My weapon is a melody.
Sing a little louder. In the middle of the storm, louder and louder, you're gonna hear my praises roar up from the ashes. Hope will arise. Death is defeated. The King is alive. I'm gonna sing in the middle of the storm, louder and louder, you're gonna hear will arise, and death is defeated. The King is alive.
I'll raise a hallelujah. I'll raise a hallelujah. I'll raise a hallelujah.
Hallelujah. I'll raise a hallelujah. I'll raise a hallelujah. I'll raise a in my soul, there's a sun coming up. In my soul, Lord, in my soul, there's a sun coming up. In my soul, Lord, in my soul, I see the light. I see the light. I see the light. I see the light.
place. My beloved, bring me away, 'cause I wanna feel the light on my face. There's a sun coming up in my soul, Lord, in my soul. There's a sun coming up in my soul, Lord, in my soul. I see the light, I see the light. I see the light, I see the light. Oh, thank you, God, I see the light.
Hey, hey!
Oh,
hey, hey!
Oh,
hey, hey!
Oh,
hey, hey!
My beloved, take me away, overjoyed and up out of this place. My beloved, for you I wait, with you here till forever, face to face. There's a sun coming up in my soul, Lord, in my soul. There's a sun coming up in my soul, Lord, in my soul. I see the light,
and greet one another, please. Thank you.
I'm going to open up in prayer, and then we'll get started. Dear Heavenly Father, I'm thankful for those who are here today and just want to pray a special blessing on the Word, and I pray that it would just become clear to us, and we'll just sense your heart that you have for us. And one-to-one, you know, us to you is huge, but also knowing your heart for the world is huge. And so I just want to pray that you would help us and guide us. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, going to be looking in Romans chapter 11. I invite you to turn over there with me, with the challenge being to understand the end game. You know, where's God taking us? Because there's a, Paul's been talking all through the book of Romans about a righteousness that comes through faith. And if you want to boil down the book, that's what it is. Righteousness is by faith. But he wants to address in chapters 9 through 11 this whole thing between, you know, whatever happened to the Jewish people who rejected their Messiah and what's going to become of them. Paul's Jewish, so he's concerned. He's realizing that obviously salvation is, I mean, going out all into Asia Minor. He's writing to the people in Rome, so the gospel's gone to the city, the capital city of the Roman Empire even. People are embracing Jesus Christ, so it's really amazing. And he recognizes these people just kind of falling away by unbelief. It's kind of where they planted their foot, is in the wrong spot. Yesterday I was out running, so I decided, well, I'm going to run for 3 miles. Now, always run in the winter, try to always run outside. So on the Greenway Trail, and as long as it's 17 or above, you know, like I'll run outdoors. So when you get a big snow like we had 15 inches, by the way, in Eagleville this last week, you'd always count on the snowmobiles to knock that, pack that trail down for you. So you don't run as fast, but it's okay because you have it. But when you start to get the melt, it starts to get icier, so you got to be careful because it's pretty pretty rigid surface. A lot of it's fine for running on, but there are spots that aren't so fine. And so I saw a strip in the first tenth of a mile I was running. I saw the strip that was just the black asphalt. I'm like, yes. You know what I'm saying? Just, you don't appreciate it until there's ice all over it. You know what I mean? Then you appreciate it a lot more. And so the first step, as soon as you hit it, I mean, your gait's so much faster because there's traction. I mean, so you spring. And so, you know, I hit that first one. Man, it felt good. You know what I mean? Because you can see the speed difference. And second step was on black ice. So that next foot planted on black ice, I was down in an instant. And once you think about it, it's tough to recover once your foot is out from under you like that. It's really, you don't stay on your feet. You know, you're just coming down because your foot's on it. It's just on a bad place. You're planting your foot on ice like that. You're going to fall. And I think of the Jewish people, and it's where they planted that foot. I mean, they're planting that foot in tradition. They're planting that foot on man's rules. They're on even the law of Moses and circumcision and holy days and stuff like that. And that's where they're planting their foot. And they're going away. I mean, they're sliding away from God. And then you have the Gentile world, and why they're getting traction and staying on their feet and having a relationship with God is because their plant foot, that's in Christ. And so that's where they're standing. They're standing in faith in Jesus Christ. And so when we look at our world and we look at all the issues that we face, I mean, that's one thing that we've got to learn right there is I got to be standing in Christ and standing in my faith in Jesus Christ and be firmly planted. And then you stay on your feet. So he has a heart for the world, and one thing that God desires that we're going to see in the top part of the passage we're looking at today, and again, you're going into now summary statements for the whole argument that he's been carrying along through 9 through 11 and really through the whole book. So they're super important verses, but you see that God's desire to change lives in verse 22, and he said, "Consider therefore the kindness and sternness of God, sternness to those who fell, but kindness to you, provided that you continue in his kindness, otherwise you will also be cut off." So there's that potential of being cut off. The Jewish people he considers as a branch lopped off the olive tree. The Gentile world he sees as a branch grafted into the olive tree. But his desire, as you go on through the passage, is that all branches will be reunited back with that tree. That everyone's going to be coming to a faith in God. I mean, that's the heart of God. But he starts out by understanding God. He said, hey, you got to realize there's a kind side of God, but there's a stern side of God. And the kind side of God would be his goodness and his help. Experienced in what way? You know, if you think about God's goodness to you, you know, how would you experience that? Is God kind? Has he been good to you? You might think for a second, well, yeah. I mean, I have a food to eat, and you look at your family, perhaps answered prayer, I think would be a huge one. Our salvation. There's all kinds of ways in which God has showed kindness to mankind. And so we look at that. And we see God who is light, and yet he has stooped down into a dark world. And that's how good God is. I mean, he's coming to a place by his own grace to help a fallen mankind. He is light, and he is working in darkness. And I think of the echo of the Jewish people in the Psalms. You know, God is good, and his love endures forever. This is constantly the theme, right? God is good, and his love endures forever. There's a good side of God. Now, this last week, in the snowstorm, I decided to go home. My wife sometimes brings me lunch, and she goes, I'm not going out that door. You know what I mean? Like, with all the snow, I don't blame her. I got a four-wheel drive truck. So, you know, I'll go get the truck, so I get it and back it out, and I'm heading out the entrance. I've been heading out for 10 years, by the way. And, you know, there's a snow coming down all over the place. I'm a typical guy. You just brush that snow off onto your hood and don't worry about it from there. You know what I'm saying? Because it's going to blow off. So if it's like looking over a tank, you know what I mean? So be it. And just go. And so I had that and the snow, and it's just one white line. So I picked the telephone pole that I thought where the entrance was. I wasn't even close. You know what I'm saying? I picked a totally wrong pole. Like, it wasn't like my wife's like, so did you get like too close to the edge and slide off the parking lot? I'm like, no, I drove straight off the parking lot. I just drove. One straight line. You look at the lines, I have a picture of it. You look at the tracks, there's no hesitation, just straight off. And then down over the bank. And so I came running back, and I got Steve, because he's got a Ram truck too, it's four-wheel drive. I said, hey, you want to play with your truck? I got stuck. He was happy to do it, of course. You know what I'm saying? So he's on his way out. Well, I went, I already got the tow strap out of my truck, and I'm messing around, and then Caleb Henry from CEI, he comes with the big truck. You know what I'm saying? The big truck with the big booms on it, like that kind of truck. Hey, you want me to pull you out? Sure. You know what I mean? Absolutely. I thought it was super nice of him to come and do that, and super nice of Steve to be willing to help. And I think that when we're on that friend side of God and we're following Jesus Christ, that's our experience, right? You know, it's good to have friends. It's good to have God there to help you out when you get off the road. That's the good side. But there's also a stern side of God. And the word stern literally means severity. It comes from a word that means to cut right off, to cut short. It emphasizes a rigor that does not bend. So I was thinking about something like a meat cleaver, all right? You take a meat cleaver to a piece of meat and you swing it. There's no flex in that blade. I mean, that blade comes down. You take an axe or something like that, there's no flex in it. That's the severity part of God. It's a judicial term, which means that God is willing to judge where he needs to judge. And when you're not coming back and you refuse to believe in Jesus Christ and you're walking away, it says that's the kind of side that you're going to find. It's kind of like a throw the book at you. Now, if you were not watching the Steelers and the Browns game, and I'm sure you all have your opinions, to the very end, then maybe you missed it. But you wouldn't have missed it the next day, because that's like all they were talking about. That's all that's on Facebook, right? That's all that's on the news, is Myles Garrett tearing the helmet off of Mason Rudolph and clobbering him with said helmet. Taking the helmet that's supposed to be protecting the quarterback, which, by the way, is the most protected player in the NFL, tearing the quarterback off, tearing the helmet off the quarterback's head, and hitting him in the head with a helmet that's supposed to be protecting his head. I mean, there are so many things wrong with it, you can't even hardly wrap your mind around it. So you knew as soon as it happened, you're like, that's a problem, right? You lost your cool to that point. You take a swing. And now, if he was swung and missed, maybe it'd be a different story. But Myles Garrett did not. He's pretty athletic. He didn't miss. You know what I'm saying? Swung straight for him, hit him directly. They threw him out of the NFL until he's reinstated for the rest of the year. It is the stiffest penalty for an in-game act in NFL history. There has never been a stronger penalty for something that happened in an NFL game than that. Now, it doesn't matter to me what you guys all think. I'm fine with it. I don't think the guy should play again this year. I don't care if they take four games away from him next year. I don't care if they take half a year away from him next year. It doesn't matter to me, because you know why? On that kind of stuff, I guess maybe I'd be a little more stern and say, that's nonsense. Like, this is nonsense. I don't care how mad you get. I don't care what. I used to tell my soccer players all the time, I don't care what somebody else did to you. What did you do to them? That's the only thing I'm worried about. I'm not worried about what the other team did. I'm worried about the behavior of my players and that you behave yourself in a manner that is respectable. And even, by the way, other players in the NFL are condemning it and all kinds of stuff. And that's stern. Like, that's coming down with, we ain't moving. That's our rule. That's our decision. Can you imagine someday standing before God? And now he's going to mete out the decision to people who refuse to embrace Jesus Christ. And he's going to open up the Lamb's Book of Life at the Great White Throne Judgment. And he's going to ask, is your name in that book? And if your name is not in that book, then what happens? It's the lake of fire. And it says that God, the other books are open where God judges. Even there, based on what you've done, the books are open. This is the stern side of God. I'd rather personally be on the grace side, right? Doing the right thing, listening to what God has to say, following Jesus Christ, believing in him. Because the kind side of God is like a soft pillow at the end of the hard day. The stern side is like an axe. I want to be on the kind side. And so Paul's reminding them, guys, oh God, let's notice here. Therefore, the kindness and sternness of God. Sternness to those who fell, meaning those who don't believe in Jesus Christ. But kindness to you, provided that you continue in his kindness. Now look, when he says continue in, that means remain. The verb here in the original language is in a mood that means possibility or potential. It is not a mood of a verb that means guarantee. It's saying that it is possible for you to continue. It is not guaranteed. The outcome is not sure unless you do. Now, I would argue that through God's work in your life, that anyone who's a true believer will persevere till the end. But salvation has a start and salvation has a finish. And what he's saying is that when you start following Jesus Christ, you must persevere the whole way through. Because the kindness is going to come to them who continue following Jesus Christ. It's an absolute commitment to follow. A commitment to believe when the storms are howling. It's like Jesus said, if you put your hand to the plow and you look back at that world, you're not even worthy of the kingdom. Because once you put your hand on that plow and you make that decision to follow Jesus Christ, then that is your direction. And that must continue to be your direction without looking back. For those who persevere, for those who continue on, he says they will be the ones who experience this kindness of God. We hold on. We hang in there. We do not give up. We do not fall back. We march on. Have you ever noticed the lack of staying power of your fellow countrymen, of people you know, maybe even family and friends? I mean, a lack of staying power in all kinds of things. A lack of staying power in exercise. The biggest month for the gym, in my experience, is always January. Every time. You will always see an influx of people that you know in another month or two you will not be seeing. They'll start strong. They don't finish strong. We look at all the things where people are in all kinds of stuff. With a pet, with a job, with a service opportunity. Start, not finish. Start, not finish. Marriage. Start, not finish. You got to finish strong, guys. You start with Jesus Christ, and we must continue with Jesus Christ, and we're going to walk that way. Even with church attendance, you can see it. Steve and I had this conversation earlier this week, and we just noticed, like, sometimes when someone's in trouble, then, you know, we see them in church, and we hear from them, help, 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 help. They get back on level ground again. They're out of church. They get into trouble. What happens? Oh, they're back in church. You see them for 3 weeks, a month, and then you don't see them. They get in trouble, the pattern repeats. My logical brain says, why don't we just stay going to church? And maybe you could avoid the trouble spots altogether, right? Not that it's always a perfect, rosy world all the time as a Christian. We know we have problems too, but you're much better off to persist. You're much better off to continue on and persevere. And not give up. This is the way it's intended to work. So perhaps you'd have less problems if you were not bouncing between the world and Jesus. You can't bounce between the world and Jesus, the world and Jesus, the world and Jesus. Continue on, continue on, continue on. These are the ones who are going to find the kindness. Now he goes on in verses 23 and 24, and he says, and if they do not persist in unbelief, they will be grafted in, for God is able to graft them in again. Now look, he's talking about the Jewish people. They've been cut off. And guess what? He's saying this. If they don't persist, continue, remain in unbelief, and they come around and believe and start following Jesus Christ, I'll put the branch back in the tree again. How's that possible? From a true analogy, a dead branch is a dead branch. It's never going back in that tree. You cut a branch off, you prune that branch off, and you throw it aside, there's no way it's ever coming back. Except for this. It's God talking. And with God, all things are possible, including salvation. And Paul's leaving it open, even for the salvation of his countrymen, that if they do not persist in unbelief, if they're willing to come back and believe in Jesus Christ, then change is possible. Now, one of the things, I'll read verse 24 before making any further comments. It says, after all, if you were cut out of an olive tree, which is wild by nature, and contrary to nature, were grafted into a cultivated olive tree, how much more readily with thee will these, the natural branches, be grafted in to their own olive tree? If they do not persist in unbelief, there's the opportunity for change, the opportunity for repentance. Now look, you guys, we've got to lay that out there for everybody on this planet. that there's a chance for anybody, any country, any creed, any religion, anybody to come to faith in Jesus Christ. You can never hold out that for somehow it's not possible. When Paul is saying that these people do not persist in unbelief, they can come to God and they can get clean. Now, can you recognize the ability of God to change people? Because I can't tell you how many times I've heard people say, so-and-so will never change. My spouse will never change. My kid will never change. That boss, that whoever will never change. How do you know that? How do you know that? Yeah, certainly personality things. Yeah, we're probably set. You know, I have a sense of humor. I probably will. You know, all my days, certain other things, you know, about me are probably going to be true. My personality is certainly not like a balloon in the wind just going all over the place. But I do believe the patterns can change. And I do believe the sinful patterns can change. And then with God, all these things are possible. I believe that an atheist can become a believer in Jesus Christ. I believe that a prostitute can become a follower of Christ. I believe that a liar can become honest. I believe that a selfish person can become unselfish. It can happen with faith if they don't persist in their unbelief and they come to God. He's saying this, I can put them in the tree. Change is possible. So as you look at the heart of God and you wonder, well, what is God up to in this world? And what does God seek in this world? What does God desire? It's that. It's that believers will continue believing. Is that the unbelieving world will come to faith. And that people will change through Jesus Christ. That's the heart of God. And that's what it's about. And so, you know, I think of Dave talking about praying for all these college campuses. Well, it's great. It's right in line with what God is doing in this world. And what God wants to do in this world. And we pray and partner with him that it'll happen. We see in verses 25 through 27, we understand that God saves from sin. Now he says this, I don't want you to be ignorant of this mystery, brothers and sisters, so that you may not be conceited. So don't be haughty, okay, because you're in the tree. Israel has experienced a hardening in part until the full numbers of the Gentiles has come in. And in this way, all Israel will be saved. As it is written, the deliverer will come from Zion and he will turn godlessness away from Jacob. And then verse 27, and this is my covenant with them when I take away their sins. Don't be conceited, guys. Why? They're experiencing a hardening in part till now. Now, one argument would be what comes first, chicken or the egg? I mean, did God harden these people and that's why they didn't believe, or did they not believe and they became hardened? And I imagine we could argue that and debate that till the cows come home. Because this is an interplay between the sovereignty of God and human free will, both which we fully believe in. We believe in human responsibility and free will. We believe that God is sovereign. Clearly, God has used the disbelief of the Jewish people, and he has allowed that then to bring salvation to the Gentile world. And if it were not for this disbelief and this unbelief in this part, perhaps we would not be seeing the revivals that we're seeing in the world going towards other people. So when they would graft in a wild olive branch, let's say, and they would graft it into a natural tree, right, to a cultivated tree, what they would do is they would cut the other branches away from around that graft to give it as much light as possible so that could flourish. And typically the tree wasn't flourishing, that's why they made the move in the first place. Because the tree, it just wasn't healthy as it could be, so they're cutting off other branches. If you want to look at this analogy, it's this. God put the Gentile world into the tree, and it could not come through the branch of Judaism. There's no way. It had to be its own thing. And God had to cut away to make as much light as possible for these people to grow and flourish. It wasn't going to come on man's rules. It wasn't going to come on our ideas. It was going to come through simple salvation and faith. So whether that starts with the Jewish people not believing, God puts calluses on their hearts, whatever the case is, the fact is what the fact was. Jewish people rejected their Messiah. The Gentile world is now coming through faith in Jesus Christ, and this has always been God's desire. I blame it on human responsibility. I think that people's hearts become hard when they repetitively don't listen. You tell God no once, guaranteed, the second time to tell him no, it's going to be easier, and the next time it's going to be even easier, and the next time it's going to be even easier. Every time you tell God no, it just gets easier. And that's why it says in Hebrews chapter 3, today if you hear his voice, don't harden your heart, because we hear God's voice in our heart. And he said, don't harden your heart. Don't you harden your heart. You're hardening your heart. God's not doing it. And I believe that when we don't believe and we're stuck in our own ways and we won't hear what God has to say to us, that's when the hardening happens. Now, two significant things that I think are super important for us to understand is what salvation is all about. Because he's making a quote now from the Old Testament, and he says this about this deliverer, right? This Messiah is going to come from Zion, and he will turn godlessness away from Jacob, and this is my covenant with them when I take away their sins. Now, two things in salvation. One is driving godlessness out of a person's life, and two is taking away sins. If you don't understand that this is what God wants you to do with salvation, you're just never going to get it, right? You've got to understand that God wants to take sins out of my life. He didn't come just to give me fire insurance. He didn't come just so I could go to heaven. He came to change my life today. So he doesn't just forgive sins, he removes sins. Now, from a national perspective, he's telling the nations, he's telling the Gentiles, he's telling the Jewish people that he's here to drive godlessness away. But any nation is comprised of families, and we can even look at it individually to the family structure of the world to understand that God has come into homes to do what? In a person's home to drive out godlessness. And to take an angry person, let's say, and to make them patient. To take an unfaithful person and make them loyal. To take a dishonest person and make them honest. He's coming to drive these things out, because that's what salvation is. It's a driving out of the evil in our own lives. And so we look at it and we realize we can overcome all kinds of temptations and bad habits. And salvation is also the taking away of sins. That's removing it, penalty, and power. You can't have salvation without this. You can't have salvation without coming to Jesus Christ, putting your faith in him, and he must remove your sins, because you can't do it yourself. Do you understand this is what salvation is? We're looking now at the heart of God. What does God really want? This is what he wants. He wants to drive godlessness out of our lives, and he wants to take away our sins. He wants to forgive them. He wants to remove the power of it. He wants to remove the penalty of it. Now, when we were on vacation the other week, we went to a fort called Fort Monroe, built back in the 1820s. It's an earthen fort with a moat around it. They actually took the earth and built this thing up, and then filled it with cannons and mortars and artilleries, and that's how they protected the Chesapeake Bay and ultimately Washington, D.C. from attack. It was a very significant fort. And so now you can just, it's decommissioned, you just go in there and walk around. And so there's different levels, a big hill, and then there's a wall, stone wall, and then there's another hill. So my family's up on the top hill, the moat's down below them, and I'm on a lower hill, and I decided I'm going to jump up there. So I jumped up there, pushed myself up, got my camera up there, took a picture of a lighthouse, talking to them. 2, 3, 4 minutes go by, whatever, jump back down the wall. I'm talking to them. I smell something. Somebody step in dog dirt? Right there. But it was way worse than that. Way worse than that. When I went over that wall, the first thing that went in it was my left hand. I didn't even know it. It was all over here, went from here to here. So now there's a big smudge of it there. It's caked. I got my left foot in. I didn't get just my hand in. I put my foot in it too, because I do it well. And so then I'm walking around up there, so my foot's hitting, like my inside foot's hitting my jeans. It was smeared all over my jeans. It's on my shoestring. I got it on 2 shoes, 2 legs of my pants, and all over my hands. Now, Chesapeake Bay, the start of it's not far away. James River, I just go out there in the sand. I'm just trying to get this off of me. You know what I'm saying? Like, I just took my shoes off. I'm washing around. I'm barefoot in the bay. It doesn't matter how cold it is or what the temperatures are at this point. You know what I'm saying? I'm just trying to get it off. I plan to take my family to dinner out there. I saw a cool place. And I get back in the car. I'm like, I don't smell anything. They're like, well, we do. You know what I'm saying? So I can't, go into a nice restaurant smelling like that. 45 minutes back to the hotel. 45 minutes it took to get back there. I washed those jeans. We washed them by themselves. in a washing machine. So when you go to hotels and you're washing your place in laundromats, just think about what's been in there ahead of you, okay? The happy thought. By themselves. Then I told my wife, what I want to do is I want to cut a notch out of one of the belt loops so I know which pair of jeans it is so I never wear them again, right? But you know what? I could never get that out myself. I mean, they needed a washing machine to get all that out, right? It had to go. Because God can't have this in his presence. He can't have us bringing all the sin into heaven. That's not going to happen. It has to be taken away. And just think about it from his perspective. Now, in all the snow, I keep slippers here. I rarely ever wear them. But if I get my hiking shoes at that point all soaking wet, or I'm wearing boots, then I'll throw them on. So I had already had them on. I was up in the reception area, had to get into my truck again, put my shoes on, left my slippers there, go back to work. I'm not even thinking about it. An hour or so later, Jazzy comes into my office with my slippers. Now, here's how she's carrying them, one in each hand, with a tissue in each hand so she doesn't have to touch them. They almost look new, because I hardly even wear. You know what I mean? They look almost new. And I asked her, I said, is that really necessary? I'm like, seriously, is that necessary? And you know what she said? I don't touch other people's shoes, Bill. I don't do it. I'm like, okay. You know what I'm saying? Yes, it's necessary. And then she throws the tissues out to Mr. Charlie. She won't even touch the tissues that touched my shoes. That's how, like, icky it all is for her. Think about God's perspective with sin. Man, it must have been pretty important that he get it off of us if he sent his own son, Jesus Christ, to die on the cross for our sins. For the purpose of, I'm coming here to take it away from you so that you can be different. I'm sending the godlessness away. So salvation doesn't look like just coming to church and putting a church label on the world. So we can look and be like everyone else and just call ourselves Christians while we're lying the same, divorcing the same, immoral the same, drunk the same, addicted the same. That's not why he came. He came to deliver us from that stuff, right? So, man, Christianity should be as different as ketchup is from mustard, as different as salt is from pepper, as different as a lemon from an orange. It's different. It's different. Because you're saved, and that's my heart, and that's my desire. And we also need to understand God's desire to show mercy, because he goes on. Now, his whole thing as you come down this final pike is there's going to be a day I show mercy on the world. As far as the gospel is concerned, they're enemies for your sake. So what he's saying here, as far as the gospel is, they're hostile to God. And God said, fine, you're hostile to me, you're hostile to Jesus, I'll take it somewhere else. This is no different than Amazon coming into New York City and saying, we'd like to build bring a big Amazon place in New York City and want to put it there and hire a bunch of people, and they fight until Amazon says, fine, I'll take it somewhere else. You're lost. Jews want to fight, crucify their Savior, not believe in Jesus Christ. You know what God says? That's fine. I'll take the gospel to the world. You're lost. Can't stop God from working. He's going to work. But you can't resist him until he just goes, I'll go work with someone else. I'll go work with somebody who wants me to work with him. You can't even stop ministry from happening, but you can stop it from happening in your life. You can't stop a good man or woman from doing good, but you can stop them from doing it in your life. They'll just take it somewhere else. You might resist it. No, I'm not going to listen to that, so on and so forth. They're just going to take it somewhere else. They've become enemies for the gospel's sake. But as far as, and that's helping them, but as far as election is concerned, it says there's still love. Because God says, you know what, I'm going to continue to work with them. I still love them no matter what. It's kind of like family. You're always going to love your family, right? No matter what they do or what direction they head. And he goes, for God's gifts and his call are irrevocable. It's irrevocable, meaning this. And here's exactly what the word means. I have no regrets. I have no regrets. I don't regret calling Abraham. I don't regret calling the Jewish people. I don't regret it. And my call to them is irrevocable. It's not going to change. My gifts to them and what I've given them, I don't regret it. My call to them, I don't regret it. So here's the thing we got to realize. When God's doing a work in his life, in our lives, he doesn't regret that work ever. His call is irrevocable. It's not going to change. So have you ever sensed that call? You ever sensed God touching your heart? Saying you need to move here, there, do this, that. And I'm not saying move locations. I'm just saying move in maybe a certain simple position to a righteous position. What's he calling you to? It says that God is calling. He's calling his own people. And his love for them is irrevocable. And I appreciate that because God chooses to love. Just like we do. Right? There are times where it's not that we love somebody because of how lovable they are. Sometimes we love because that's a choice. And we're making a choice to do it. And that love then becomes irrevocable. it becomes, we don't regret it. We should never regret doing good in someone's life, right? We should never regret reaching out. We should never regret showing love, right? Because if that's something God called us to do, we don't regret that. That's what God's saying. He goes, I don't regret what I've done. I don't regret it. In fact, in verses 30 through 31, it says, just as you who were at one time disobedient to God have now received mercy as a result of their disobedience. So Paul recognized, yeah, their disobedience. But they too have become disobedient in order that they too may now receive mercy as a result of God's mercy to you. Look, the same mercy that they showed, that God showed you, he's going to show them as they turn back to him. As they start realizing, seeing what God's doing in your life, they start realizing the hole that they've gotten themselves into. And by the way, this can happen to any individual. They look around at the hole they're in, and they start to realize, man, I need God. Because until you can see your need of mercy, you can't receive it. Until you can realize you're disobedient and you're that person who has sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, you'll never receive the mercy of God. As long as you have a haughtiness to you and think, I don't need God, and for some reason I don't need his work and I don't need his hand in my life, you'll never receive it. Paul's pointing to a day when the Jewish people see it. That has not happened as a nation yet, but we know someday it will happen. There's going to be a day when they come and they realize as an entire people that Jesus is their Messiah, that God is doing a work, and they're going to have to come from that place and realize we blew it then to step into the mercy of God. And sometimes we never fix our relationship with God because we don't realize the disobedience, therefore we can never step into the mercy. Even ruptured relationships, when you can't realize what you did to rupture it, the person will show you mercy, but you got to step back into that, and it's, you step back into it from a position of, I realize I blew it. I'm disobedient. Their disobedience is going to lead them to God's mercy ultimately because they will see it. And in verse 32, it says, for God has bound everyone over to disobedience so that he may have mercy on them all. And that's like, literally, this is a term which would be wrapping a net around all the sinners. Putting a net around all of them someday so I can show mercy to all of them. These fish have swum into the, they swam into the net themselves. They swam into it. God gathered them. But what does God want to do for the world? He wants to show what? Mercy. This is no different than what Paul said in Romans chapter 1. God gave them over to the reprobate thinking. God just got out of the way. Let them go their own way. But ultimately, here's what God wants. I want to show mercy to these people. I want to show mercy to the sinners. I want to show mercy to the wayward. I want to show mercy to those who have gone astray. When they come back, that'll always be the key, you guys. You got to come and put your faith in Jesus Christ. Because righteousness is by what? Faith. Verse 32 is not skipping out of that theme. That righteousness is by faith. There's going to come a day when they have faith in God. And when they do, they will receive mercy. I'm going to tell you what. Anyone who walks through these doors and wants to put their faith in God, I don't care what their past has been. Do you guys agree with this? They should find what? Mercy. Why? Because this is the heart of God. This is the care and concern of God for this world. He wants to save it. He wants to show mercy. He wants people to change. That's what God wants. Now, some of us, no matter what God wants, they're still going to do their own thing. But there's always the door open to come back. There's always room for the prodigal to come back in. Let's stand as we close this time in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, I just thank you for your word and the power of it. I'm glad that you change lives. I'm glad you're a merciful God. I'm glad you give people a chance. But sometimes, God, we've got to see it. Like, we've got to see our own disobedience before we step into mercy. Because it's from this position of humility that we can experience it. We have needs, God. We need Jesus Christ. We need cleaned up. We need sins taken away. We need that, God. I pray if anyone here has never accepted that, they've never kind of come in and gotten the junk of the world washed off them. May they, through faith in Jesus Christ and his death on the cross, experience that washing today. May they call out to you and just ask, God, would you forgive me of my sins and give me eternal life? Help us, God. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.